Books on Tape presents High Druid of Shannara, Tanequil, by Terry Brooks, read by Paul Boehmer. Chapter 1. Sen Dunsadan, Prime Minister of the Federation, paused to look back over his shoulder as he reached his sleeping chambers. There was no one there who shouldn't be. His personal guard at the bedroom doorway, the sentries on watch at both ends of the hallway, no one else. There never was. But that didn't stop him from checking every night. His eyes scanned the torchlit corridor carefully. It didn't hurt to make certain. It only made sense to be careful. He entered and closed the door softly behind him. The warm glow and sweet candle smells that greeted him were reassuring. He was the most powerful man in the Southland, but not the most popular. That hadn't bothered him before the coming of the Ill's Witch, but it hadn't stopped bothering him since. Even though she was finally gone, banished to a realm of dark madness and bloodlust from which no one had ever escaped, he did not feel safe. He stood for a moment and regarded his reflection in the full-length mirror that was backed against the wall opposite his bed. The mirror had been placed there for other reasons, for a witnessing of satisfactions and indulgences that might as well have happened in another lifetime, so distant did they seem to him now. He could have them still, of course, but he knew they would give him no pleasure. Hardly anything pleasured him these days. His life had become an exercise conducted with equal measures of grim determination and iron will. Political practicalities and expediencies motivated everything he did. Every act, every word had ramifications that reached beyond the immediate. There was no time or place for anything else. In truth, there was no need. His reflection stared back at him, and he was mildly shocked to see how old he had become. When had that happened? He was in the prime of his life, sound of mind and body, at the apex of his career, arguably the most important man in the four lands. Yet, look what he had become. His hair had gone almost white. His face, once smooth and handsome, was lined and careworn. There were shadows in places where his worries had gathered like stains. He stood slightly stooped, where once he had stood erect. Nothing about him reflected confidence or strength. He seemed to himself a shell from which the contents of life had been drained. He turned away. Fear and self-loathing would do that. He had never recovered from what the Morgar had put him through the night he had drained the lives from all those freeborn captives brought out of the Federation prisons. He had never forgotten what it had felt like to watch them become the living dead, creatures for which life had no meaning beyond that assigned by the warlock. Even after the Morgar had been destroyed, the memory of that night lingered, a whisper of the madness waiting to consume him if he strayed too far from the safety of the pretense and dissembling that kept him sane. Becoming Prime Minister had imbued him with a certain measure of respect from those he led, but it was less willingly bestowed these days than it had been in the beginning, when his people still had hope that he might accomplish something. That hope had long since vanished into the rocks and earth of the Precandoran, where so many had shed their blood and lost their lives. It had vanished with his failure not only to end the war that had consumed the four lands for the better part of three decades, but even to bring it closer to a meaningful conclusion. It had vanished in his failure to enhance the prestige of the Federation in the eyes of those for whom the Southland mattered, leaving bitterness and disappointment as the only legacy he could expect should he die on the morrow. He walked to his bed and sat down, reached automatically for the goblet that had been placed on his bedside table, and filled it from the pitcher of wine that accompanied it. He took a long drink, thinking that at least he had managed to rid himself of the intolerable presence of Grianne Ohmsford. The hated Ill's Witch was gone at last. With Shedea Aru as his ally, even as treacherous as she was, he had a reasonable chance of ending the stalemates that had confronted him at every turn for the last 20 years. Theirs was a shared vision of the world's future, one in which Federation and Druids controlled the destinies and dictated the fates of all the races. Together, they would find a way to bring an end to the freeborn Federation War and a beginning to Southland dominance. Although it hadn't happened yet, and nothing he could point to suggested it would happen anytime soon, Shedea's failure to bring the Druid Council into line was particularly galling. He was beginning to wonder if their alliance was one-sided. She had the benefit of his open support, and he, as yet, had nothing. Thus, he was forced to look over his shoulder still, because doubt lingered and resistance to his leadership grew. He had just emptied his goblet and was thinking of filling it anew when a knock sounded at his door. He jumped in spite of himself. Once, an unexpected silence would have startled him. Those he feared most, the Ill's Witch and the Morgor, would not have bothered to knock. Now, every little sound caused the iron bands that wrapped his chest and heart to tighten further. He gave them a moment to loosen, then stood, setting the empty goblet carefully on the table beside him. "Who is it?"
"Apologies, Prime Minister," came the voice of his captain of the guard. "A visitor wishes a word with you, one of your engineers. He insists it is most urgent, and from the look of him, I would judge it to be so."
A pause.
"He is unarmed and alone."
Dunsadan straightened. An engineer? At this time of night? He had a number of them working on his airships, all of them assigned to find ways to make the component pieces of his fleet work more efficiently. But few, if any, would presume to try to talk to him directly, especially so late at night. He was immediately suspicious, but reconsidered as he realized that an attempt to see him under these conditions indicated a certain amount of desperation. He was intrigued. He put aside his reservations and irritation and stepped to the door.
"Enter."
The engineer slid through the doorway in the manner of a ferret to its hole. He was a small man who lacked any distinguishing physical characteristics. The way he held himself as he faced Sen Dunsadan suggested that he was a man who recognized that it was important not to overstep.
"Prime Minister," he said, bowing low and waiting.
"You have something urgent to speak to me about."
"Yes, Prime Minister. My name is Orek. Eaton Orek. I have served as an airship engineer for more than 20 years. I am your most loyal servant and admirer, Prime Minister, and so I knew that I must come directly to you when I made my discovery."
He was still bent over, not presuming to address Sen Dunsadan as an equal. There was a cringing quality to his posture that bothered the Prime Minister, but he forced himself to ignore it.
"Stand up and look at me."
Eaton Orek did so, though his effort at meeting Sen Dunsadan's practiced gaze failed, his eyes preferring to fix on the other's belt buckle.
"I apologize for disturbing you."
"What sort of discovery have you made, Engineer Orek? I gather this has something to do with your work on my airships."
The other nodded quickly.
"Oh, yes, Prime Minister, it does. I've been working on diapsin crystals, trying to find ways to enhance their performance as converters of ambient light to energy. That has been my task for the better part of the past 5 years."
"And so?"
Orek hesitated.
"My lord,"
he said, switching to the more formal and deferential title,
"I think it best if I show you rather than tell you. I think you will better understand."
He brushed at his mop of unruly dark hair and rubbed his hands together nervously.
"Would it be too much of an imposition to ask you to come with me to my workstation? I know it is late, but I think you will not be disappointed."
For a moment, Sen Dunsadan considered the possibility that this might be an assassination attempt. But he dismissed the idea.
His enemies would surely come up with a better plan than this if they were serious about eliminating him. This little man was too fearful to be the instrument of a prime minister's death. His presence was the result of something else, and much as he hated to admit it, Sen Dunsadan was increasingly interested in finding out what it was. You realize that if this is...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.